of Space Education and Research Foundation, and on my personal behalf, I'm very, very happy to welcome Professor Sarnam Singh and all the participants from 330 different countries to this webinar, which is a course of remote sensing technology. And today we are going to have fourth talk by Professor Sarnam Singh, and this will be on fundamentals of geographic information system. Before I hand over the mic to Professor Sarnam Singh, I will say very few words about him. Professor Sarnam Singh is a dean and senior professor at Nalanda University, which is an international university and a very ancient place of learning in India. Before joining Nalanda University, he had worked at two premier institutions in India. One is Botanical Survey of India and Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, Dehradun, which is a unit of ISRO. He is a very accomplished remote sensing and geoinformation systems experts or pioneer in India, and has a very long teaching experience. So it is our great privilege that we are learning remote sensing and geoinformation system from a scientist of the caliber of Professor Sarnam Singh. With these very few words, I now request Professor Sarnam Singh.
Good morning to all of you. This is the fourth talk in this series, and I must thank Professor Vass for introducing again. Today we will discuss about the geographic information system. This has become a very important technology, and the integration of remote sensing and GIS, that's how we call it, can provide solutions to many of the activities or actions which we do or take up into day-to-day natural resource management or any decision-making process. Today we will discuss the importance of the GIS and try to understand what it means. And then the question comes, why GIS? What it can do for us, and then how we can develop the concept of GIS, because conceptualization is very important before we really go ahead with it. And then how it functions, this is also very important. And before we take up any GIS work, there are certain requirements. We should know what are the basic requirements, maybe in terms of the computer, maybe in hard disk requirement, or maybe in terms of RAM requirement, maybe software requirement. So that is very important. And then there are many ways to look at the data type. There could be so many sources, and there are different ways of representing. So we'll also discuss into that. GIS is known for data analysis, basically. So any software or any program which you probably would like to take and either buy or download from the open source, the analysis has to be very strong. The two things we have to always keep in mind, one is the input and the next is the analysis. Then overlay functions, we will briefly touch, because this is a very big area for discussion, but still we will try to look into that and just tell you what are the current trends in the GIS. So let us look at the importance of the GIS. As I said earlier, we normally do it for natural resource management, for effective planning, sustainable management of the resources, whatever we have, and whatever the actions are required so that we can get timely information, and where that action has to be taken, that location is very important. So we get timely information, and for the location information, that is very important for us to do that. We can talk about the forest, We can talk about the water, we can talk about the soil, agriculture, geology, marine, any of these disciplines. I have listed many, many important areas where we can use GIS. Almost in all fields of day-to-day life, maybe resource management or even any other decision making, people are using the GIS. It has become almost indispensable for us. So you can talk about the inventory of the forest, you can talk about watershed management, you can talk about the soil type data, maybe crop acreage estimation, cropping pattern analysis, maybe geology, faults, lineaments, where are the minerals found, you know, all that analysis required, we can always take up. Similarly, marine, where are the mangroves, whether they are healthy, and if healthy, then what types are there, then accordingly you can create database. So that means this is a technology which is very much useful for almost all kinds of requirements. Now, all these resource managers, whoever is going to be there, the most important is they collect the locational information of any resource which you are talking. I just listed here agriculture, forestry, soil, let us say glaciers or geology or physio, anything which you want to do, it's very important to have the location information. And that's what I have written in the center, where is what. That's very important. If we have to act or do anything, we should know what is there, where it is. So there will be always few questions to be answered if we take these modern technologies, and that's where these are very useful. This type of information, that means locational information on the earth of the earth surface, is basically called geographic information. And if you do it systematically and develop a database, then we can call it as a geographic information system. Let us try to define it. I'll try to make it very simple. It's basically a tool, or you can say set of tools. The first thing is to collect the data. That means we should have some means to collect the data. Then we try to store the data, and the normally, as per the current trend, it is the computers. We have hard disks, so we store the data there. And the very important is the retrieval at will. That means whenever we want data to be retrieved or displayed, we should be able to do. So that is the criteria for our GIS. Similarly, if I want to transform the data or display the spatial data from the real world the way I would like to have, that is a very important aspect of the GIS. Clark 86 has defined it a little different. A computer assisted system. Basically, computer is very important because there are a lot of complicated activities to be done. So data capture, storage, retrieval, analysis of the spatial. So more or less the words are same, the emphasis could be little less or more depending upon the person to person. Let me also tell you, friends, this is basically a technology for integrating the data from different sources. So you can see it is a technology of integration, and I have mentioned disciplines down. You can talk about geography, you can talk about the cartography, photogrammetry, remote sensing, surveying, geodesy, civil engineering, anything. Everybody who knows computer science, operation, artificial intelligence, anything you think about, it can become part of the GIS. So it is a very important that we have an overview of what GIS has the potential. So next question comes, the why we need GIS. I have just put 3 points here. Paper maps do not provide possibility to look into underneath maps or layers. Let's imagine we have 4 or 5 maps, paper maps. If you overlay or you put one over the other, you will find you are able to only read what is on the top, only that map. What is below that, you may have soil map, you may have geology map, you may have water resource map. You will not know what is below that. Let us say if we take transparent sheets, suppose our maps are on transparent sheets, we can also look into them. Some information can be there. Let us say you can have 2, 3, or 4 layers, but if you have, let us say, some 6, 7, or 10, 20 layers, it becomes difficult even on the minor or transparent sheets to see what is below each feature. So this GIS provides you an opportunity to overlay the data spatial data and see through. That means you can put the cursor, you can find out what are the attributes of that particular location. You can try to analyze and you can try to get answers out of many layers. That means you can put query, putting all kinds of conditions and try to generate some information which is going to be very useful. So what can GIS do for you? That means first thing is you can create maps. So you may have one map and then from you can have several maps and from several maps you can create one map also. Very important thing is visualization of the scenarios. So we can provide alternatives. We have a lot of activities in each of the countries, maybe dam, mega dams construction or mega highways construction or any infrastructure development. What is going to be the impact? What is that area? What is the neighborhood? We can visualize instead of going to the field. We can do all that kind of visualization here itself. We can integrate the data and we can also do the analysis using very powerful ideas. GIS is, I tell you, endless. You can put all kinds of ideas and then you can try to analyze. That is the beauty of the GIS. You can develop effective solutions and you can also automate a lot of labor intensive tasks and then try to do the analysis of the very complicated actions. So what are the objectives of the GIS? First thing is to automate several time consuming and tedious aspects of mode production. One thing please remember, a GIS is a one time effort. It may take more time to create the GIS database, but once it is created, then you save a lot of time in again updating or revision or analysis. It takes less time. But first time, yes, it takes little time, but afterwards it doesn't take much time. You can manipulate the data. As I said earlier, you can do the visualization and find out the alternatives. You can provide alternative this one, alternative two, alternative three. So you have the options given to the decision maker. If you choose this, then this is going to happen. If you choose B, this is going to happen. That kind of visualization is available in GIS. You can do the overlay analysis. It has the capacity to do many kinds of modeling. Nowadays, almost everybody is talking about statistical modeling or empirical modeling or mathematical modeling. So if you have a database, certainly you can try to put into all your ideas and do the analysis. It improves the efficiency of your planning and decision making. We can maximize the efficiency, as I said earlier, and provide efficient means and also try to avoid redundancy of the data set. Each country will have a lot of redundancy in the data set, so this is very important that we remove that. So let us see what GIS can answer. First thing, it can tell you where it is, that means location. Then it can also tell you what is the condition. If you have the criteria, you can also find out where it is, what about it is, and what trend analysis you can do out. If you have a lot of data, you can do the trend analysis, you can find out the patterns of the distribution. And you can do the modeling. This is very simple example I have given. If you have a conditional analysis, you can do what if A is equal to this, B is equal to this, then C is equal to this, then else, and you know, then zero, something of that kind. We can do the analysis. So this is very much doable in the GIS, and nowadays we are doing this kind of activities. Let's try to understand the concept of GIS. This is very important. If you look at this data, I have given you some blocks are there. Probably you will take some time to understand what word you can make out. That means there's a lot of mixing of the data. That means it's all jumbled up. That's the real data. In the real world, you will find all this thing. We can try to organize this data. Say, for example, I can reorganize this data and it becomes a banana or a cat or a, you know, another set of animals like deers. So this is again a kind of data which is you have organized, and still it is not in geospatial form. That means it is not a pictorial form. What we can do out of this is we can certainly then improve it and create this kind of a graphical database. That means instead of writing what it is, we can put a picture here. So picture gives you a lot of information. So that's what GIS basically does it for you. You have a descriptive analysis done, you have graphical analysis done, you have descriptive way of presentation, you can do, you convert it to the graphical way of conversion. That gives you a lot of, you know, handle so that you can try to improve the working of the analysis or whatever you are trying to. There are basically two types of the data set in the geographical GIS. I mean, one is the spatial, that means any polygon on anything which has an area, we call it spatial data. Non-spatial data means point data, that means you only know the X and Y location, that means we know only latitude and longitude of that area. It can be field observation, let us say some you saw some animal or some accident has taken place, or some census information which is only for that point. It does not have a spread, that means it is not in spatial. So we have two spatial, I mean spatial and non-spatial data sets. How GIS works basically, so first thing is to capture the data, both spatial and non-spatial data is captured using some devices. Let us say you can take scanners, you can take any digitizing tablet, you can do all that. Then next comes how to convert data and do the integration, and then have a projection system. That means each country will have its own projection system, like normally we follow UTM, which is 84, one data projection system, but each country can have separate depending on the what kind of scale you are working on. Then we can also require to know what kind of data structures are required, because you know you will have a lot of data, redundancy has to be avoided. So there are a lot of formats available for that, how to put your data into so that it becomes easy access. And then relating each data from different sources, because the relationship is very important, then only one can do good analysis in GIS. And last point, of course, is the modeling. This is very important, and you can do the all kinds of visualization. Yesterday, somebody asked what is layer and the coverage. Yesterday, we can discuss in that. So the concept of layer and coverage basically in GIS is most important. In GIS, normally, if you are talking about real GIS, you should have n number of layers. You can have maybe 10, 20, or 30 layers. So they are basically layers, or they have attribute. Each layer will have a separate attribute. Each feature will have a separate attribute, so that we can call it as a coverage. That just examples I have given here, let us say forest type, soil texture, anything, vegetation type, geology, road, anything becomes one layer. And then we can over, if you look at this diagram here, let us say this is a real world. So you have a water body, you have some trees, you have some landscape here. And then we can convert into this kind of a vector data. We can put lines on it and then say, okay, this is vegetation, this is water body. And we can convert this data into raster. That means these are basically small, small units. Yesterday we discussed about the what is a raster. So we can convert. So there are two ways of representation. First is the vector, second is the raster. Analysis is possible in both ways. Only thing, there are advantages and disadvantages of each of the type. So probably it will depend upon what you would like to do and what is the area you want. So what kind of visualization we can have? We can manipulate data, we can analyze data and display. That's very important. This kind of diagrams you'll always find on the internet. You can see in the middle, this is a simple map which indicates there are roads, there is some canal here, and there are some, you know, bylanes and all that. If you take satellite data, you can see here some green things are there, some features are there, yellow, some agriculture is there. So you can take geology map or you can take terrain map and then try to draw on the digital elevation model, and then you can visualize what is that. So this is just an example how visualization works in GIS. Where from you have to collect the data? Just few examples I have given you. First thing is to get the existing maps. Each country will have a survey department. So first thing is to get the maps from there, depending upon the scale, 1:10 or 1:50,000, whatever is your requirement, kindly procure. First thing is that. Then we go to the field, depending upon the again objective, what kind of analysis and database we are expecting. We take the field measurements and try to create a database of the observations. We can also use aerial photos, we can also use satellite images. Yesterday we discussed about the mapping part, so that map can straight be imported into GIS and you can start doing the analysis of it. Let us look at the different components of the spatial data. First thing is the location, that means X, that is the longitude, then Y, that is the latitude, and then you can also put other attributes also. Nowadays you can put even altitude also, so that it is an endless process. Then we also attach a attribute to each of these component, let us say if it is a point, we can say this is a, let us say, temple, or let us say this is a well. If it is an area, we can say this is a city or this is a forest, all that. And third dimension, we can add time series, because if you would like to monitor the data, what is happening, would like to try to trend analysis, then we need time series data, and then we can create that database also. So year can be there. So there's a very little complicated, but once you understand how to create this attribute table, then it becomes very easy to generate maps one after the other. Just I give you an example here. Let us say there's a tree in the center here. And then what we would like to know, where this tree is standing. So we would like to know latitude of its longitude, what is the altitude of it, and when this observation is taken. That's very important. Then next thing comes, we can have some more attributes, like what is this plant, what the species which is growing there, what is the height of the tree, what is the age of the tree, what is the diameter of the bole or tree here. So that means you have a location information here, and you have the attribute information here. So both information put together becomes a complete GIS database. So let us go into requirements. Before we start, the first thing is that input from maps, aerial photos, satellite data or survey, whatever you have, you should try to collect all that. You should store all the data, try to have the good mechanism of retrieving and querying. So GIS software selection is very important at this stage. And then data transformation from this projection to that projection, or you know, you get maps into different scales. Some maps you may get on 1:50,000 scale, some maybe on 1:250,000 scale. So how do you transform from one to another? There could be some amount of error in. So that also GIS can help you to do that. So do analysis, modeling, and generate the statistics on that. And then of course the final output will be that we'll have maps, we'll have reports, and then whatever your recommendation you are giving in terms of the plan that is given there. So let us look into different steps of GIS database creation. The first thing is input and verification. That means we try to get some data and try to input. Nowadays, a lot of data is freely available also, so you can also try to do that. So first thing is the transformation of data from existing maps. Okay, so we can have digitization of the paper maps. We can have a scan, or you know, nowadays scanners are available. You can have classified data as input. You can have a visually interpreted maps from aerial photos or satellite data. You can have the field data. So these are the input layers. We use either a scanner or your mouse or your keypad to enter the data. Next thing becomes, what is the accuracy of the data which you have input? So then we can take a print and overlay on the original maps, and then see whether the polygon shape is retained or it is deteriorated. Because if your polygon shape is not proper, you will have area difference, and many administrators will not accept when area is wrong. So that's a very important part of. And then you can also match the entries which you have made from the table one by one. So once your database is free of errors, then you can try to start analysis. I'm just a caution here, a shape of the polygon has to be retained. Please avoid redundancy, because the GIS is meant for to avoid redundancy. Nowadays, this is very much important because you have huge amount of data. And to how to keep the curves, you know, you will have a lot of irregular curves. So we always suggest that you take more vertices at those curves. So don't put in a straight line, take more vertices so that shape of the polygon is retained. That's very important for us. Second step is to store. That means we should choose a proper database management system. Nowadays, a lot of database management systems are available. Relational database management systems are available. Once you have digitized, the next thing comes the attribute assignment. That means topology building. Topology is basically defining the polygon relationship with the neighboring polygons. Suppose you have a vector, and what is the left side of the vector, or what is the right side of the vector, that you have to tell the computer through building topology. And then we can run the polygonization so that it takes all the polygon becomes one unit. There are many times that you lose data, so kindly take backups, and then as I said earlier, you can do the data transformation from different projection to whatever projection system you would like. So that's the very good potential of the remote sensing and GIS both put together. Then comes the out-connect presentation. So you must do some pre-processing of your data, a lot of cleaning and weeding may be required, data checking may be required, and then you do the analysis and query. So whatever the user may want, what is the area, what is the perimeter, or what kind of science you would like to do, all that analysis is possible using spatial and non-spatial data, either in combination or independently. It all depends on the objective which you are trying to do. So your analysis is always user-oriented or objective-oriented, we can say. And then you should show your results to the user, and then user should also try to interact with you and tell his requirement whether he is satisfied or not satisfied with his requirement. So just to summarize here, this is just a flowchart. So what kind of database we would like to create, that's the first step. So these are the different data sources we have discussed. We input all these data sources using scanners or any other method, and we create a spatial database doing editing, storing, and all kinds of basic requirements. And after modeling, we do the output generation. And then these outputs are basically tables, images, statistical database, or other database. And that means from data, we are converting and getting the information. That is what GIS provides you. That's very important part of it. As I said earlier, that the best part of GIS is that the strength it has to allow you to do the analysis. If you are not able to analyze the data, you might have created huge amount of terabyte data, but if you are not able to do the analysis, then it is not of much use. So it is very important that you plan in such a way that depending upon the requirement or multiple requirement, your database should be created in such a way. So we are discussing about the query, simple query, spatial query, single layer operation, multiple layer operation, modeling, surface analysis, network analysis, pattern analysis, grid analysis. There are immense potential to the different kind of analysis with the once the database has been created. So what kind of questions it can answer? Just would like to summarize here quickly. Let's say, what do we want to achieve with GIS? That's the first question we should try to answer. Where and how do we want to employ GIS in organizational structure? That's again very important, because it is not of use. You start doing something and you may not find any user, you may not find it very useful. So before you do that, please do all these steps. What kind of data is required so that people can use it and it can be populated? That means data can be used and edited and manipulated the way you would like to do it. Where do we find this kind of data? What are the sources? What kind of data analysis we would like to do? Where will we store this data? Who will be responsible for looking after the GIS, because it is not just digitizing and leaving it alone. Somebody has to keep it update. What kind of sensor survey methodology is required? What does our user expect from us? What kind of dissemination process we are going to follow? And who is going to fund? So this is very important aspect that before we do is required for any kind of a GIS. So let us look into the different sources. We may have point data. That's I put here one dot. This is a point. This is only X and Y. So I know only latitude and longitude of this. You can have n number of examples which I've written here. You can have a segment of line, like this is a line either straight or irregular. So it will have so many X and Ys. That means you may have n number of X and Ys. If it's a straight line, you will have only two, starting and end point. And then you can have a polygon so that it has some area, it encircles the area, it's called a polygon. It can be any map which has area, you can depict here. And if you would like to show that in a surface, three-dimensional surface model or something, so we have nowadays DM models available. So in three axis, that means you have a third axis also added, and then you can visualize in three dimensions. That means you have a continuous data variability whenever you are trying to analyze or visualize that data. Just to give you some examples of data representation, so this is vector, the dot, This is again the cross is again XY location of this thing. This is a node, a starting node and ending node to draw a line. Simple. And to draw a polygon, starting line or starting node and the ending node is same. So this is the difference between a line and a polygon. A line will have a starting node and ending node. They will not be same. Whereas polygon will be closed. That means you start distancing or creating it from same point and again you snap it or end to the starting point. So this is called a polygon. This is called a vector representation. I can give you very simple examples of vector. Like we put signature, we do any kind of writing letters or anything. This is all vector. Draw a line by your hand is all vector data. So this is best way to understand. Then we have the raster presentation. We have discussed in the previous lectures what is a raster. These are basically gridded. Grid is of course slightly different, but as a just to understand and to explain you, I'm just saying. So grid will have a independently, but you can have cells which will have same value. So you can represent in any format whichever is good for you, and you can then process the data the way you would like to do it. Just an example here. Let us say this is real world here. So I have a house here, I have a few trees here, and I have a single tree here, and then I have a road here, let us say. Okay. So if I digitize this, you can see here, this tree becomes one point here. House also becomes one point here, edge. And this forest area, I try to digitize the boundary of it, it becomes a polygon. So you can see this is a polygon here. And then I can digitize this river, and then it becomes a river here. So you have a lot of points for a river, you have only one point for point, that is for house and the tree, and so many points for drawing a polygon along. Now this is a vector way of working at. I can convert this into raster also. So if you look at the left side of the diagram, so it has more area depending upon the cell size. So tree is there, house is there. You can see shape of the polygon has distorted a little bit here. So these are forest or trees here. And the river also, it is not very nice shape, because you can now see there are different breaking kind of things happening here. So that is the disadvantage of raster, that you will have some kind of accuracy loss at this stage. Quickly, so I will advise you to scan at 300 dpi, because you need to have a good line that digitize. You can have thematic layer, do the cleaning and weeding for errors, remove all the errors before you proceed, do the attribute assignment, do polygonization to spread the point from centroid to the boundary, do the rasterization, because this is very important to save on your hard disk and make faster analysis, and do all the pre-processing for the and finalization. Just to give an example here, suppose we have a vector data, you can convert it to raster data. The grid size, raster size will decide what will be the shape of it. If cell size is very big, it will have very irregular shape, zigzag. If you have very small raster cell size, then you can nearly correct or nearly accurate shape of the road or whatever vector you are talking about. So this is also very important. If you have a more number of raster, then the file size increases, and then accuracy improves. But if you have a big size, then accuracy decreases, file size. Let me come back to I was discussing about the advantages and disadvantages of vector and raster and the cell size, and then how GIS is going to support us. So we have less time. I would like to push through the presentation now. I'll touch upon the important part of it. So first thing is, if I have to do the analysis, I can do the attribute query. So I can find out, suppose I want to know, I want the villages which have fire history, or I want to know villages or areas where you have a degraded forest. I can do that kind of query. I can also do the spatial query. So I can set a distance that within the radius of 2 kilometers or 5 kilometers, how many villages are there, or what is the nearest road. All that kind of analysis is possible using GIS. So you can do the single layer analysis, multi-layer analysis, you can do all kinds of modeling, network analysis for road, nearest shortest route and that kind of analysis. You can do the surface analysis, like what is the view available to you, all that you can do, and then you can use either grid or raster analysis for that. you can do the data retrieval, reclassification operation, overlay operations, you can do region transformation, neighborhood analysis, connectivity operations, all this is possible using. I just take an example here. Suppose I have a map, let us say this one, which may have IDs, these are your centroid IDs, then you have the land use and land cover class, let us say forest type 1, 2, 3, and settlement and agriculture and water body. I may have the same attribute, I may have a biomass transfer per hectare for forest type A, forest type B, forest type C. And I also will know whether forest type is high biodiversity or forest type is moderate diversity or F3 is low diversity. So all these in one table, I can have all these attributes and then I can create all these maps from the single table. I can create all these different type of maps just by using called reclassification. So this is all possible. I give an example here. So let us say on the left side, this map is a map which we might have prepared. It has all the classes of, suppose I want only forest and non-forest areas for some purpose, I can just a click of a second, I can find out that these are the forest areas, rest is non-forest area. I may also be interested to just to know where is the teak forest, let us say, so I can just find out only teak forest. I may be interested to find out only moist deciduous forest where it is found, I can do. So these are all very quick operations you can do using the reclassification functions. There's immense potential to do all kinds of analysis, analytical analysis, like you carry out the arithmetical analysis, you can do the logical analysis, you can call them as Boolean operators, or you can also do the condition analysis. It all depends upon the your easy and your confidence, which kind of operations or which kind of procedure you would like to take up. This is just an example. Suppose you have a map A, I want to multiply it by 2, then I can create another map. So multiplication is possible. If I want to do some kind of subtraction, all is possible. Addition, anything is possible, multiplication. So this is the potential of the, we can do the surface analysis. That means I can do local operation, I can do the neighborhood operation, I can do the global also. So this suppose we have a grid and from the point I can extrapolate, find the distance or surface. There are many possibilities to do this kind of analysis. We can overlay from different parts. Let us say I have a forest type map, I have a forest density map. So I overlay these two maps, I get a third map here. If I add soil map on that, I get the fourth map here. I can add the communication map, I get a final map here. So all these possibilities are available in the GIS, which you can manipulate. Very important are the logical operators. I think you must have studied about this AND, OR, XOR, and true and false operators. So they are very important and they are called Boolean operators. A and B means you are trying to find out the true conditions. A not A means it's zero. A or B, either of it, you can have one. XOR means it adds to two, that means becomes ultimately nil. So all this is possible. Just understand what these operators are trying to do. I just give you a few examples here. Let us say I have a polygon A and I have polygon B. And if I would want to do A and B, then I will have this result, the common area, which will be highlighted. So that is the function of A. Similarly, I can do OR, either of these, both. That means you are adding to it. A lot of potential is available to do all this kind of analysis. So please understand the logical operators and the role of brackets is very important. So we move to the next. We can do the conditional overlay. That means I can put statements if land use is equal to 1, or density is equal to A, or water width body is less than 2 kilometers, and road is more than 5 kilometers, all this is possible. Then say it is 1, else it is 0. So this kind of analysis you can carry out, and then you can get the final map for your, that's what you want to do. Very interesting and very often used overlay operation is we call index overlay operation. These overlay operations are basically you can take n number of layers, and what do we basically assign? We assign weights at map level and weights at the attribute level. So let us say I have 3, 4, or 5 maps, and I can say okay, this map is more important than this map. So I have the, let us say out of 100, I can assign a weight of to one map, maybe 10 or 20, the other map, my 5, or maybe 50 to other map. It all depends upon your understanding what you would like to do. This is a very important aspect of it. And then within the map also you have the attributes. That means basically I'm talking about the legend. Out of all those classes, which class is more important, which class is less important, that also you can assign weights according to the choice. There are many methods to do the weight assignment. One simplest method is called pairwise comparison. You can compare all these items one by one and then you can give the ranking. That is all possible. There are many software available for you. You can also do that also. So it's not a very difficult task, but this is very interesting tool to mostly use for any complicated analysis where you have a lot of conditions put and try to analyze the suitable sites or suitable habitats or suitable for any kind of application. That's what we try to do it here. There's a very interesting thing. GIS also allows you to carry out the analysis related to the zones of influence. That means, let us say there is a factory or there is an atomic energy station, power station or thermal station, or maybe a road. So you would like to see, so let us say there's a road, national highway or express highway. What is the noise level? So noise level is very high near the road. As you go away from the road, it decreases. So that means you can do this kind of analysis. We call them as buffers. You can have the interval buffers or you can have a continuous buffer. Both options are available in GIS. Or let us say you want to do an analysis. You have a thermal power station, say you would like to analyze how far the fly ash is going. So you can do 1 kilometer, 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers based on the direction and the based on the capacity. So all this is possible to find out what the zone of influence of a particular activity. This is very much used nowadays for any kind of impact assessment. What will be the impact if some certain activity is done at certain place? And that's how we try to do the analysis using GIS. That's almost end of my talk, and we had a lot of interruptions today. What are the current trends? Many times nowadays people are talking about networking. So you have internet GIS. That means it is not important that you buy the software, GIS software. There are a lot of websites, national websites also. You can go there. You can choose the layers from there. You can apply the algorithm which you want to do or do the analysis. It will be done at the other end and results will be available to your terminal. So this is also a very good way of working, that you don't have really database at this place. So you can use the facility like a centralized database of country or state or any organization, and then try to do the analysis. Nowadays a lot of open source GIS is available, so you have freedom to write your own program. You can modify the programs. You can improve the programs. So this is also very much available to us. We can use this program. If you do not have much money, we can use these software which are available in the in the GIS domain. Open source, they are available. You can always use. Another very important information now people are developing out of GIS is called decision support systems. There are in most of the systems we'll have two, three types of the organizational structures. Somebody will carry out the work, somebody will do the take a decision, somebody will implement that. So that means, let us say as a remote sensing expert or GIS expert, our duty will be to provide inputs to the decision makers. Decision maker could be anybody in your country. I mean, could be a head of the organization or head of the government. Anybody could be the decision maker. So this is a technology which supports the decision making process. And that means I can generate scenarios 1, 2, 3. I can generate alternatives 1, 2, 3. If you do this, then this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. This gives an opportunity to decide, okay, what should be done actually. So it optimizes the decision making process, which is in best in terms of the environmental or let us say even social implications. A new trend has also started now called the web services, just like internet GIS. It is more or less similar. Web services, again, instead of you download the data from their website, you can use the data there itself, and whatever you would like to do, or you have your own data, there are many ways to handle, and the web services is also available. A lot of information systems are now these days being developed. You have a huge amount of database created for your country. You can create database related to, let us say, transport system, housing system, forest system, or biodiversity system. You know, all these information systems can be put together, developed for your country, and put on the website, so people will be using it actually. So this is very important, and people should contribute so that you have a GIS database particular related to one theme available, so that we don't repeat these actions and we don't waste our time. So with this, I think this is the end of my talk today. These are some references. These are the good books which you probably can refer where basics can be understood, because this one lecture would not be sufficient to understand all these concepts. But yes, I recommend you to go through this thing. That's it, and maybe very many thanks for it, and we will now take up the question and answers. Thank you very much for your comments. Very nice to learn something new. Okay. Components of GIS. Thank you very much for appreciation, but I will be more like to know what you have not understood. Kindly put those questions which probably I can take this opportunity to interact with you, and maybe I can try to answer also. Yeah, we had a link problem today several times. I can only apologize for all these things. Yeah, there is a question. You know, we don't want to miss. Yes, I fully agree with all the participants. Let me also tell you, you have my email ID there on the second or third slide. If you want to interact with me, yes, you are free to do. There's no problem. I will be very happy to clarify your doubts. Fine. I don't see any question. Only accept this disturbance. There is a question by Neil. Says, will it differ when we digitize on a 30 meter resolution image and overlay it on a higher resolution image? Yes, there will be, certainly, because 30 meter pixel will represent an area which is on the ground 30 meter by 30 meter. So when you draw a pencil or you digitize a polygon or vectorization, you will certainly have the shape of the polygon will change, and shape of the polygon will decide the area of that area. So it is important that we take best resolution available to you. I won't say that you get 1 meter resolution or half meter resolution. It all depends upon the objective which you are trying to achieve, and accordingly you will choose the. So there will be always some kind of a compromise between the scale and the objectives, and then time given to you, and manpower given to you, and funding given to you. So please don't worry about that. Yes, there will be some impact, but it's not matter. Ultimately, we have to go to the ground to implement any recommendation. So there it doesn't matter. You are going to see that area in real form. So it hard, if you know that there is some problem that side, go there, you will yourself find that area which has some problem. So don't worry about too much, but certainly there will be some. It will be interesting. If we put any obstacles in front of RS, then it works or not? I really do not. What kind of obstacle we are trying to put? If you put an obstacle in between, that means you are obstructing the reflectance of it. If reflectance is not reaching to the sensor or camera or whatever object you are trying to do, naturally you will not get picture of it. So we would like to have a clear picture of that object. So we would not prefer even the clouds, when they also act as an obstacle when we try to capture satellite data using remote sensing satellites. So we would like to have a very good data so that we don't have to bother about searching again and again data. Question like the GIS and GPS interconnected. GIS is a process to create database and analyze. And as I said, if you remember, I give an example of a tree. and we need the GPS location of that tree. So either you use a GPS machine or GPS instrument to get the data of any kind of information you or data you would like to collect or integrate, or you use some maps. So once you have registered your maps to certain coordinate system, automatically it will show the latitude longitude, so you don't have to worry. If you have a fresh data collected from a area, of course then you need some kind of a GPS information. So they are all related. That's why they say remote sensing, GIS and GPS, they are all integrated, and the common term is geospatial technologies. So it covers everything, input, output, and the requirement of all these things is there in the team. There is a question, how to use GIS in geographic modeling. This is from Ujjwal. Let me tell you, Ujjwal, this is a very important. See, GIS is, the strength of GIS is in the modeling. So if you have a GIS database created, you will have, number of options open to you to manipulate the data. So please, only thing you have to do is choose a proper software to do the modeling. If you are good in writing your own programs, excellent, please do that. So you can go to open source GIS software and then try to improve as per your requirement. Is GIS, there is a question from Madrela. It says, is GIS and remote sensing correlated? How? Okay, I think GIS is a technology for integrating the data. Okay, so you can say it is a larger umbrella. Remote sensing is technology to acquire the data. So remote sensing takes the data, you make a map, that map becomes input to the GIS. So you can say remote sensing is one of the tools to collect the data or generate information, which then is fed into GIS and integrated with other layers or other coverages and do the analysis. In fact, they go together, but they are basically different. But remote sensing is a subset of GIS, if you have to tell that way, we can say it. Okay, there is a question on what is cartography and photogrammetry. Yes, cartography basically is to draw lines and assign some attributes. Yes, photogrammetry is to find out the dimensions of it. We can find out the measurements. That means if you use the photogrammetric techniques, you can find out the height of a tree, height of a building. You know, you can find out all the dimensions of that. So that is the, you get 3D visualization in photogrammetry. You can create 3D model in that. That's a photogrammetry. Cartography is very simple one. Any, any architect or designer who does the paperwork for any building or is basically a cartographer. But if he creates that database into some kind of information, better than that, may be part of the GIS. Okay, there's a question from Juhi. Please explain again how buffers help in impact assessment study. Yeah, this is a good question. We all know the impact of any activity. You can take up any example. Let us say I take an example of a dam which is, has been either created or is being built. The maximum disturbance will be near to the dam. As you go away from the dam or any activity site, the impact decreases. That means disturbance decreases. So there is an inverse relationship between the distance and the disturbance here. So as you go away from it, disturbance decreases. So you have to go to the field and look into what is the impact distance of that activity. So maybe half a kilometer, 2 kilometer. So you, and then once you know that, then you can categorize, okay, very high disturbance, moderate level disturbance, or nil disturbance. So this buffer distance will depend upon the objective, depend upon the activity which you are trying to assess. Let us say if you are trying to do the impact assessment of fuel wood collected by the villagers. So villagers can go maybe 5 kilometers inside the forest. So that impact is 5 kilometers. Or if enough resources are available, they don't go to the forest inside, they can collect from the boundary of the forest and come back. It could be only half a kilometer. So it all depends upon the resource availability and what is the impact, how far people are traveling to collect that information or to collect the resources there. We got many answers which were asked. Okay, thank you very much. Yes, that's what I said. And by the end of this webinar series, probably we all will be better informed. We'll have lot of you know information shared. There are so many. This is question for weather forecast GIS is useful. Let me tell you, normally weather forecast is a phenomena which is observed in a very large area. Okay, it's not a short or a small area or little area event. And basically, many times you may not have very much use of it. But yes, we can use that. Let us say cyclone is coming, we can find out how many villages are going to be covered. We can overlay, we can take a satellite data and overlay the village map. We can overlay the district map on that. We can overlay the population map on that. We can overlay the river map on that. We can overlay the road network map. So anything is possible to overlay. So you can then generate information how many villages are going to be affected. So GIS is useful almost everywhere actually nowadays. It's almost all fields people use GIS. There's a question from Mohammed Asif. In India, does GIS technology use? Okay, let me tell you, India is one of the biggest users of the GIS technology. We started sometimes in, you know, I mean, 90s or early 90s, and now it's almost every organization, every maybe unit which is related to research or any kind of resource management talks about GIS. So in India, it is very much used. And we have n number of companies, n number of professionals available to do all these things actually. What are the topological layers? There's a question from Amisa. Yes, see, first thing you understand, what is a topology? Topology is the relationship between the neighboring polygons. So if there's a line in between, so what is on the left side of the line, what is on the right side of the line? That means you try to establish a relationship between, that's how the computer recognizes. See, basic thing when we talk about GIS or remote sensing is how to talk to computer. You cannot talk to computer like, you cannot give commands. Okay, you do this or you do that. We use keyboard or mouse to execute any function. So we try to give input. Okay, I want to do this kind of analysis. So I say, okay, if this A, then condition B, this condition C, this condition, and then press okay, you get a result. That's how the But if you do not assign topology, if you do not identify this is a river or this is a water body or this is a forest, then computer doesn't know what it is. It only understands there are some lines, that's all. So we need to assign an attribute. And then that means this basically to define the area of that attribute, how long, how big is that, that's part of the topology. And it is very important before you do any kind of analysis. There is a question here, very interesting. I think not beyond my scope of this discussion. How is it possible that modern generation aircrafts are not caught up by radar? I think today's discussion is not on the radar and the this detection technology. We are discussing about GIS. Certainly, you will find answers if you consult some experts who are dealing with the security, they will be able to probably inform you better. Okay, this is a very good question. Can GIS sustain without map? If you have a map, if you have do not have a map, that means you can create a map using non-spatial data. That means you may have billions of points. And from that also you can create a layer. So that's not an issue. The idea is that we should have the attribute assignment to each of the features or each of the points or each of the polygons or segment which we are going to enter into the computer. Once you have done that, then always a lot of modules are available. You can do all kinds of extrapolation or interpolation techniques are available and you can generate a map. But basic idea is that in GIS you need to have a map. So map. Otherwise, what is the user? It becomes then simple a CAD. That means you digitize and you give it to somebody. So we want to use GIS for some resource management. So that's why maps are important. If you do not have a map, suppose you want to generate a map of your area, you have a water body and you do not have a map. You can take a GPS, walk around there, come to the same place, you press a click, you get an area of that. that can be input to your any kind of analysis. So that is all possible actually. There's a question from Jisa. Which are most accurate and easy pattern, polygon or line of GIS for getting accurate information of sustainable development area? Okay. Polygon also is a basically line. Please try to understand. Line has only two points, starting, ending. That means I have XY of starting point, I have the XY of the ending point. That's called the node. That means starting node and ending node. Same thing, if starting node and ending node becomes the same, it becomes a polygon. So polygon also is formed by a vector. Line is also vector, polygon is also a vector. So it doesn't matter actually. So you can convert this, you see initially when we do digitization, it is a line only. If you join the lines, it becomes a polygon. So that's not a problem. It all depends what kind of objectives you are doing. Accuracy of the digitization will determine the accuracy of your area assessment. If you are very careless in doing that, you will have very rough estimates of the area or maybe wrong representation of the results also many times. But if you digitize carefully, particularly the curves, so you should always be careful. That means you take more vertices near the curve, so the shape of the curve is not distorted. That's a very important part when you do this kind of data inputting. One has to be very careful about it. It's a question from Anderson. What are the advantages of using vector data as compared to raster data? Vector data takes a little more space on hard disk. Raster data little less because you can compress. We discussed about data compression techniques. There are many techniques. Raster data analysis is very fast. Vector data could be a little slow, but nowadays doesn't matter because you have high-end computers. Vector data is accurately representing the feature, accurately. So your all analysis, area analysis or results are going to be more accurate or better than the raster data. Because raster data is a generalization of that feature. Whether you talk about 10 meter by 10 meter or 20 by 20 meter, it's a generalized information. Whereas vector is real, so you will always get a better results using vector data. So this is the advantage of the using vector data. But vector data digitization takes more time. So that is one aspect we have to consider. Okay, I think I have already answered this question. Difference between the raster and vector data. If you recollect my diagram, so vector data was basically a line. And raster data, these are gridded. So you have so many squares coming up, these are called cells. And the representation, if you have a cell, let us say 5 meter by 5 meter, and your road may be only, let us say 4 meter wide, you are going to wrongly represent. So vector data is always better too, and better gives the accuracy of the results which you are going to get. Madela, thank you very much. She writes, GIS is fun and more interesting by interacting with you. We will be very happy. We would like that you make your career in remote sensing and GIS in any field where are you working. So I would like to wish you all the best. I don't think now any question which I need to look into seriously. And if there is anything left, probably we will look into afterwards. So thank you very much to all of you and good luck. So we'll meet on Monday for the next lecture where we will discuss about the application of this geospatial technology, because my field of area is basically forestry and ecology, so I will be picking up examples from this disciplines only. But certainly we can, if there is any general question, we can also pick up from other fields also. Thank you very much and wish you good luck.